Blackstone Publishing presents Sword of the Caliphate by Clayton Martin. This book is read by Chris Abell. For my wife, Carrie, for saving me from a dark path. Chapter 1. Preface. I remember where I was when the war started. Not the little brushfire war we had with Iraq and Afghanistan, though I remember where I was when that one started too. No, I mean the big one. What some people would eventually call World War III, though it made the previous two look like a dust up in the schoolyard. The one that took us to the brink of extinction. How we got there didn't seem to matter at the time. It never does in a crisis. All that mattered back then was staying alive. Age and what I hope is wisdom has changed my perspective a bit, but it is tempered with a healthy dose of cynicism. I've always had that, and what I saw over the years didn't do too much to dissuade it. I don't think even foreknowledge of what would happen really would have changed anything. All the warning signs were there, but the population chose to ignore them, a recurring theme in history. People were busy going to the mall and watching reality TV. Nothing bad could ever happen to them. The political class was busy getting rich off the backs of everyone else, maintaining the status quo. Business as usual. Much too busy to think there could actually be a crisis big enough to upset the trough of easy money. The cable news liked to talk about dirty bombs and EMP attacks once in a while to boost ratings, but none of the so-called experts saw what was really coming. All the conventional wisdom of the day liked to tell us that terrorists were outliers. Islam was actually a religion of peace. The mad mullahs were just barking. We rattled sabers and talked a good game about keeping Iran and North Korea from acquiring nukes, but that was mostly just to keep them away from the big boy table. Pakistan acquired its doomsday weapons well before that and was subsequently invited to be taken seriously. Nukes had so many safeguards in place, red phones and direct lines and serious-looking diplomats, that they had basically become status symbols for statesmen. If you had the goods, you could run with the grown-ups. If you didn't, you could expect to have your nose rubbed in the dirt at will. No more, no less. No one really expected the missiles to fly, not when there were so many luxuries for leaders of nuclear nations to indulge in. They might occasionally puff up at the ancient enemies, but that was theater for the peasants. The elite class was never going to end life as we know it, not with so many pleasures to keep them entertained. I suppose no one ever sees a paradigm shift coming. But one was on the wind, and it would answer a question the soldiers from the pointy end of the stick already understood, but that no Washington Beltway or Downing Street desk jockey could fathom. What would happen if one of these savage-eyed Bedouin lunatics preaching about a new caliphate ever actually acquired a doomsday weapon? Simple. He would use it. My name is Derek Martell, and this is my story. The story of how mankind was almost pushed into the abyss. How we fought back, how we bled and died by the thousands to claw our way out from the darkness. The terrible price we paid, and how I survived. At least for now. Chapter 2. The day the world almost ended, I was manning a mostly irrelevant outpost on the Iranian border. It was a long fall for a man like me, but the pay was decent and the odds of getting shot were higher in Chicago. So I had that going for me. Officially, the name of the place was Combat Outpost Kramer, named after some poor bastard that bought it back in 05. The plaque near the front gate said he was a paratrooper from the 82nd, so he deserved better than what COP Kramer had become, which was a glorified gas station. We called it 7-Eleven and, unfortunately, home. I was not that long retired from 3rd Special Forces Group, a victim of Obama's purge of the warfighters in the years leading up to the end of his second term. Why was I at a refueling depot in a godforsaken corner of the sandbox, not running Commando Steve missions of daring do and glory? Good question. I asked myself that plenty of times, too. Most of it had to do with the Great Purge, which had driven down the price of labor across the board for all of us former ninjas. 2021 was a rough time to only possess the skill set of killing bad guys, with the decline of American power abroad. Our first orange president had lasted only long enough to wipe ISIS off the map before the opposition party managed to have him and his VP impeached, mostly on some made-up charges and some highly sketchy testimonies. The soy boy Speaker of the House became president and picked a recently pardoned Hillary as his second, hoping to appease the populace since she won the popular vote. A few days later, he resigned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.